This is Getting Started Writing Pony Fanfiction. I hope you're in the right place. I hope I'm in the right place. I think we all are. We're cool. I'm glad there's more than zero of you. That's awesome. I'm Coffee Minion, like it says right there. I am on Fanfiction. If you would like to find a copy of these slides, you can go there, look at my blog. Latest blog post has a link to the slides. It's probably the most efficient way of getting it to you, honestly. Alright, so here's what I'm going to be going through today, and I'll apologize right now. Got the sniffles a little bit, so if I sniffle at you, it's better than the alternative. I'm going to go just a little bit about me. Don't know if you guys know me. I don't expect you to. That's cool. Then we're going to, you know, get into the real content here, you know, kind of setting your expectations as you get started writing pony fan fiction. I'm going to talk about, you know, how I see, like, the writing process as a whole working. Give you some tips, some things to do, maybe some things not to do. Gonna talk a lot about feedback. And speaking of feedback, I've got a lot of slides, but honestly, if you guys have questions, feel free to just jump in there. It's seriously not a big deal. If you hit on something I've got in a later slide, I might say so. Otherwise, it's totally cool. Yes.
Can this also be pointed to, like, drawing comics as well?
Ooh, drawing comics. Well, let me think about that. So, that's a different skill set than I have personally. It's a different realm of experience than I have. I'll tell you this. I think that the art of putting together a story is probably somewhat similar. I mean, you need different parts of a story. You need to take it through a review process, in my opinion, in order to get best results. I hope that there will be some good content for you. Just generally speaking, it might not hit you, it might not exactly hit you dead on, but hopefully there'll be some good content for you. I know there's at least one slide toward the end that will hopefully speak to you. All right, so a little bit about me. I will ask the most dangerous question I could possibly ask in this panel. Has anyone actually heard of me before? No is a perfectly acceptable answer, and that's totally cool. Not exactly a huge person in the fandom. I'm just glad to be here. Some of my favorite authors right there. I've been doing this for almost 10 years in one capacity or another. Ran into MLP kinda, sorta, little bits here and there, but didn't really get hooked until 2014. I totally blundered into Fanfiction by accident. I was trying to figure out when season 5 was gonna get started, and found myself at Equestria Daily, found links to stories, got sucked in. So I have a piece of feedback here that I got from my very first story that I think kind of helps to set a useful tone as you look at maybe getting started. O. Calhoun, who's got a lot of good stories, said, my story was the Toyota Corolla of stories. Solid, practical, and dependable, but a Ferrari it isn't. Not exciting. It's an example, perhaps, of when skilled writing meets mediocre storytelling. Ooh, that was a little hard to hear, but that was also kind of encouraging, and kind of like, I want to do better. So my goals for today, talk about my experience. I've only been doing this for a year, but it's been a lot of fun. I've learned a ton of stuff about writing in general. I hope it's applicable to writing in general. It certainly seems to be applicable to writing pony, so I'm going to hit on that level as well. Give you some tips that I think would be useful if you're getting started. And I want to offer you guys a lot of encouragement. You're going to hear a lot of reality too as I kind of go through this, but I also want to encourage you guys because, you know, you go get started, you know? It's cool. All right, enough of the intro. Let's get this going. All right, so the basics. How do you actually physically get started writing pony fan fiction? Who's heard of fanfiction.net? Yes, excellent, very good. All right, so you know where to go. Write something, hit submit, and your horse famous, right? So, who's actually written a story and submitted it before? All right, not everybody. Excellent, but some people, that's good. So, that first story, right? That go okay for you guys? Feel pretty satisfied? Okay, all right. If you feel satisfied with the experience, that's awesome. That doesn't always happen. Like, sometimes you get downvote bombed. People don't like your stuff. People don't read it. You might get negative comments, you know? That can happen. Like, if you're thinking of getting started and you haven't written anything at all, keep your expectations low for that first one. You know, there's nothing like being a new writer with that you know, gray featureless avatar, you know, one story, zero blog, zero followers, right? You stick out like a sore thumb. That's okay, right? That's okay. Starting out, it can be kind of rough, right? I don't know how Fallout 4 is, but all the previous Fallouts, the Fallout game series, you kind of start out, you don't have much stuff, kind of feels like the deck is stacked against you, you got to kind of struggle to survive, you know, you just don't have a lot of resources on your side. You're like, I'm never going to get on top of the power curve here, this kind of sucks, right? But it can get fun. I have made friends through Fanfiction. Like last night, as I was finalizing this thing, I was up at like Lord only knows what o'clock with my buddy Moosetasm, and we're just going through working, you know, just kind of working this thing back and forth. You know, we chat about stuff. It's like we've always got a PM thread going between the two of us. It's a lot of fun. Like seriously, it can be a lot of fun doing this stuff. As far as feedback goes, I personally, like, I've been doing this for almost 10 years, you know, writing in some capacity, but in the last year that I've been doing pony fanfic, I've gotten so much more feedback. So much more. And not just like, oh, you're good, or oh, you suck, but like, hey, this aspect of your story is not, like, quite right. Oh, that's really useful feedback, right? And I threw in a couple of plugs here for a couple of stories I wrote. I shipped a straw with a bag of flour, and I totally made it work. It's a funny story. Check it out. I will also say, yes, I have gotten one story in the feature box one time. It was pretty cool. You can check that out, too, if you like. Welcome. This is Pony Fan Fiction. Are you Pony Fan Fiction? Because I am. All right, but seriously, as much as it can be fun, at some point you're gonna sit down, right? You got your Word doc, you got your Google doc, you got your pad and paper, like whatever you do. And you're gonna sit there and you're like, I don't have any ideas. I'm not very good at this. I don't know what I'm doing. Yeah, I mean, that's gonna happen, right? So when you get there, here's kind of like my first big tip that I would try to impress upon you guys, a little bit of my experience with my philosophy. Developing ideas and drafting a story and then editing that story, those are like three separate things, arguably four, depending on how picky you want to get. I have some things up here, you don't have to read all of them. The gist of this is that if you try to mix these things together, it's like drinking and driving. It's fun, you can totally do that. Yeah. No, results may vary on that. Because the thing is, it requires a different mindset. I feel like to come up with an idea, to develop an idea, if you sit down and you're like, I will write now, and you don't have like a developed idea that you're writing off of, it's frustrating because you're like, oh, I need this idea. And then like you start writing, you're like, oh, this idea sucks. Or like, you know, you're writing out a paragraph, you're like, oh no, I didn't say that very well. Yeah, you're not gonna get very far, and it's gonna be very frustrating, my experience. So separate those things. The process of coming up with ideas, keep it completely separate as much as possible from when you're actually trying to write stuff. Just embrace the fact that ideas can come at you randomly if you're ready to write them down. So like, if you're the kind of person who is comfortable keeping like a physical notepad with you, like a little teeny notepad in your pocket and a pen, that's great. Or if you've got a smartphone, which everybody pretty much does these days, you know, just like keep a note file on your smartphone or you know, get the Google Docs app on your smartphone and then just have like an ideas Google Doc. I have this really long, awful idea list of just like raw, unfiltered ideas that I've jotted down. And when I say idea, I don't mean like a complete plot outline and narrative arc and blah blah blah. I just mean like I'll give you one that this is my beautiful idea that I have no idea how to develop into a story yet, which is why I haven't. Discord, it's 5 o'clock somewhere. So like Discord's trying to relax and it just all just goes to Tartarus, right? Okay, so what's the story there? Well, that's the thing. There's not a lot of story to that specific idea. You need to develop that, so I'm going to talk about that here. But like, it can be just little things like that that just kind of stick in your brain and go, you know, there might be something to that, right? Maybe, maybe not. And that's okay. Like, when you're coming up with ideas, don't shoot it down like, ugh, this idea sucks, because you don't know. Just capture it. Just write it down. I mean, 6 months later, you might have an idea that you wrote down that you're like, no, actually, I think I could turn that into a story. I had that happen just just recently. It's kind of fun. Finally got to use an idea. This has a lot of words on it, so let me tell you what this is all about. This is kind of my personal philosophy on how you take that like raw pile of ideas and start developing it into like stories. So basically, and I'll say here, sorry, I just got a text message. This is my personal philosophy, okay? So this is not like some famous author is telling you this, but I have found this to be very helpful as I've kind of developed it over the last, let's say, 6 months. I feel like I get a lot of mileage out of this personally. Here's how I develop ideas into stories. There's three things I'm looking for when I'm trying to like corral these ideas. And as I say there, usually my ideas show up with like one or two of these things, and I've got to like find a third thing that fits it. Thing one, a character who wants something. You need characters in your stories, right? And they need to be like on a quest or like or it could be something perfectly domestic like, I want my coffee, right? I need my coffee. Live. And then you have a situation that's keeping them from getting it, like, I'm sitting too far away from my coffee. This is a terrible example, but it's what I have at hand. Then you have a second character who can help them if they're willing to give something up. So it'd be like, I can't get to my coffee. Can you get me my coffee? Right? So again, this is like horrifically bad examples of ideas, but like there could be a story here, right? It's like, you know, maybe my arms are like unable to get the coffee, and I have to persuade you to stand up and bring it to me, right? Or, you know, and so then there could be a story where, you know, a comedic story where I make you laugh and I talk you into doing it, or a tragic story where I'm trying to persuade you to do it, but you know, my hubris actually alienates you and you walk out, right? And then I don't get the coffee. Or, you know, while doing this, I realize, wait, you know, coffee is, you know, a foolish thing to desire. You know, one should aspire to tea or water in life, you know, and I grow personally. You know, I don't get what I want, but I gain fulfillment, right? It's like with those three really basic components, you can tell all kinds of stories. But again, that's kind of how I take an idea or a couple ideas, and I say, all right, do I have enough stuff here that I think I can maybe get a story out of it? Again, feel free to jump in at any point if you have questions. Yes?
What does your OC look like? Do you have an OC for
you? Ooh! Yes, I do. I will Google around at the end and try to find that. I do not have my OC handy.
That's like PonyCon 101.
This is my first PonyCon, so I will plead ignorance. But, that's a good question, and that has an answer. I will get that.
Okay.
Let's see. So when you, as you like, so you've got some ideas, and you're like, okay, I'm gonna write a story. It's helpful to at least keep an eye on what people are really looking for, right? Welcome to Pony Fanfic. Come on in.
Hello.
All right. So what are people looking for? And this is not trying to discourage you, but just like, be aware. People want to be impressed. So, Horizon. Horizon is a great author. He's way better than me. Go check him out.
He's my favorite author.
Really? Excellent. Good taste. This was a review for a specific story, and it's not a review of your story or my story or anybody's story. It's one specific story. But I read this review, and I'm like, ooh, you know, you can apply this to, like, just about any story, right? People might consider a story kind of lower middle of the pack, you know, like not all that impressive. You know, if it can have smooth writing, good characterization, basically functional but not exciting. Kind of like that earlier quote from O Calhoun on my one story, right? It's a Toyota Corolla, it's not a Ferrari. You know, I want something that's kind of impressive. And the last bit there I think is maybe a little bit relevant. There's nothing here we haven't seen almost exactly in the show, right? So, especially in fan fiction, you're kind of walking a delicate line. You've got these characters. People like the characters. I know. We'll get to the bottom of the slide in a second. Don't worry about it. And I'm not trying to hate on anyone out there, all right? It's just, it's there. I'll get to it. People, you know, we have these wonderful characters that we can work with, right, from the show. they have all sorts of, you know, developed personalities, tastes, interests, things they like, things they don't like. And you know, that can be a real benefit to you. But as you're writing fan fiction, oftentimes what people really would like to see is kind of taking a character and kind of putting them in a situation that's like, that you wouldn't just see in the show. I mean, I think there is, to some extent, a market, there is to some extent a market for like, just things that really feel like they fit into the show, and wanting to feel like it could fit in the show, I think, is a desirable goal, but people, I think, kind of want to see you develop, the unseen, you know, sides of Equestria, or, you know, the unseen sides of characters, or things that they can't necessarily do in the show. Like, you know, the episode where Tank went into hibernation, right? It's a metaphor for death, because they can't really address death in the show. You can address death in your fan fiction, right? But you want to do it in a way that feels like it makes sense for the characters, because if you don't, you're going to lose people. That's why I have the Twilight and Flash Sentry thing here. Not, so if Flashlight is your thing, I am not here to hate on you. It is not my goal. My goal is to say that this is a specific example of something that generated controversy, because Twilight, she's brainy, she's smart, she's awesome and amazing. Flash is a doofus in high school. OTP. What? Again, I'm not trying to hate on you. I'm trying to say enough people in the fandom have found that kind of like, that, you know, that third friendship, or, you know, Friendship Games movie, they weren't exactly doing the Twilight Flash Century thing a lot strong, right? I think even Hasbro's pulling away from that one. Again, I'm not trying to bash anyone who ships Flashlight. I'm just saying, it has to kind of pass that, like, does this really fit test? Okay, you had a question.
So, basically, you want us to keep it almost to a real extent, but also keeping true to characters. Like, Pinkie Pie, she works at a bakery, but she might also have diabetes.
Oh, that's a good example. So, yeah, so keep it... Yeah, exactly. You're walking that line, right? You know, actually, that's kind of cool. I don't know if anyone's done that. You know, Pinkie Pie works at a bakery, but also has diabetes. Wow, you could probably get a pretty good fic out of that, right? Yeah. No. It is? Oh, I'm sorry. See, and that's the thing. I haven't read everything out there, right? I mean, so I have basic ignorances you can easily call me out on. I'm sorry.
There's only like a few golden eggs within the whole basket that seem to be almost real, but at the same time keeping true to the characters.
I know. So what I'm challenging you to do is hard. I know. It's hard. it's hard to walk that line. So one of the things I'm going to get to a little bit later is pre-reading and the value of having someone look at your stuff like before you release it, and I think that's kind of where that comes in. Like, you know, like just to jump ahead a little bit, it's hard sometimes to maintain perspective on your own work. Like, is this working? Is this good? Is this funny? Like, I like to write humor, comedy, and one of the hard things about comedy is like, you know. You, what you think is funny might, like, totally offend someone, right? I mean, it can happen. I had that happen with, like, an early draft of two of my stories, where I was like, wow, what are you doing? And I'm like, well, I don't know, what am I doing? And they're like, that's offensive. I'm like, really? And it's not like, I mean, okay, maybe I could be dumb, I could be insensitive, but it was like, oh, really? I learned something there, right? I'm not going to get specific on it because I think there's no value in getting specific on it. The point is, sometimes you don't have 100% perspective on your own stuff and if it's working, but if someone catches you on that before you release your work, that can be really beneficial. So I mentioned shipping, and my editor encouraged me to throw in a slide about Scub. I don't know if you've heard of Scub. I'm going to tell you about Scub. Here's a comic about Scub. People are pro-Scub, anti-Scub. They fight. They fight a lot. What is Scub? It's some random thing. Here's the point. Not every idea is going to appeal to everybody, right? Not every ship is everybody's thing. I don't know what an appropriate metaphor is. Oh, cup of tea, I guess, would be the metaphor, right? whatever. I'm sorry. Not every idea is going to appeal to everybody, right?
Not every
Some
idea.
Things, you know, people are going to see it and they're going to be like, oh, I hate that so much. Some people are going to see it and be like, oh, I love that so much. That's awesome, right? You know, when you're getting feedback, when you're getting responses, right, or even when you're reading other people's stuff, just kind of be aware, right? Some things kind of set people off, and you got to kind of check that for yourself. Like, if someone's like freaking out about this thing, does that mean I've done something wrong? I need to take some feedback here. I need to see what I can learn from this experience. Or, you know, is it just that, you know, like back here, Twilight and Flash Century is your thing, and the fact that I used an example of it here means that you hate me forever. It's like, I can't help you if that's the case, right? That's the point here. And that's another thing just to be aware of, you know, especially as you do shipping, right? Because, like, people have their favorite ships, and they have their least favorite ships, and they fight, right? It's like there's nothing you can do past a certain point. All right, so, next up. Very deep thoughts about the drafting process. So we've talked about coming up with an idea. We're going to talk about editing in a minute. Right now, we're gonna get some deep thoughts about the drafting process. On your mark, get set, go! These are my deep thoughts of the drafting process. Do it quickly. Get your idea. Get some music. Get a timer. Start writing. Okay, here's what you do. Have you ever done NaNoWriMo? Has anyone done NaNoWriMo?
Well, what?
National Novel Writing Month. You've done NaNoWriMo. The idea is to write a lot quickly. It's the month of November. It's an annual event. The goal is to produce 50,000 words in November. Yeah, you gotta write like a madman to pull that off. It's hard. Here's the thing. Here's the gist of this slide. Drafting. Go. Do it. Write things that suck. Write crap. Just get stuff down. Take, you know, you've spent time thinking and developing your idea. You're going to clean stuff up later. Let's go accrue some editing debt. Because you know what? You can't edit a story that isn't written. This is the thing that hangs people up all the time. Hangs me up, hangs lots of people up. You got to get in there and write something. And you're like, oh, but what if it's no good? I write it and yeah, I know. Yeah, it's... Your first draft will suck. That's fine. I talk about breaking the writing process apart into separate components because they require separate mindsets, separate skill sets, separate approaches. This is the approach for this part. Just try to get something. Yes, you will reuse words too often. Yes, you will misspell things. Yes, you might have run-on sentences or paragraphs. That's fine. As long as you understand that we're going to have to fix that up, go write it. Because if it doesn't exist, you can't fix it. You don't got anything, right? Those are my deep thoughts on drafting. Just do it. Do it in like 30-minute stretches. Challenge yourself to see how many words you can write in 30 minutes. Yes?
There's something that might help other people too. There are programs called Write or Die.
Write or Die, yes.
How that works is it's a website, and you type into a text box on the website. And if you don't type a new word in like 5 seconds, or even change the parameter and make it 3 seconds, then the screen will gradually turn more and more red until finally it glares at you until you write a word.
Yep.
You can also set parameters so you can't use the backspace, so you can't revise what you've written. There's a bunch of ways you can do it.
Yep. Write or die. Yes, that's... I have not personally used Write or Die. I feel like I can achieve something similar just with just whatever, you know, Word or Google Docs or whatever. That works for me. If that works for you, I know a lot of people who've used that. That's cool. That's a great tool. Check it out. So again, we're going to have to fix this, but you can't fix it if it ain't written. All right. Editing process. Slow down. Slow down there, champ. Okay. Cool down. Drink some water. Relax. Take a nap. Okay. Your draft is going to be pretty crappy, and it's going to need lots of editing. Sorry. That's how mine start out, for what it's worth. As you gain practice, like for me now, I find that I can't write, I cannot write as fast as I could, let's say maybe 4 years ago, you know, using this approach. And I find that, yes, I do kind of edit a bit as I go, selectively, very selectively. I've been doing this for a while, I know when it's like, oh, that's wrong, and I just need to fix it, as opposed to like, hey, this needs a macro edit. I will now spend 5 minutes macro editing this sentence. No, I don't do that. Right, just, you've gotten it down on paper or whatever, now we're gonna fix it. Okay, probably the most important thing you can do is a spelling and grammar pass. This is another quote by Horizon. It's a review of a specific story, but I felt like it was generally applicable. The sad fact is that surface polish has an outsized effect on how readers view your story. Okay, but if you keep giving it your all, you'll find yourself improving quickly, right? So, funny example, in this sentence here, that first sentence I had an extra word until my editor caught it. I had "is that that surface" in that first sentence. So, yeah, that would have looked really stupid if I had had that up here, wouldn't it? You would have been like, hey, he's got a typo up there, right? And you know, that's one of those things about fan fiction, right? Welcome to the fanfic panel. You know, if you've got lots of typos, lots of, like, really weird grammar, people are going to be like, what the heck is this? And they're going to, like, walk away, downvote you, like, or just ignore you, right? You want it to look kind of polished. It doesn't have to be amazing, but, you know, you need to hunt down the typos and grammar issues. I find that a lot of spell checkers that come default, like in Word or Google Docs, they don't necessarily catch everything. I don't have a resource to give you guys for, like, the magic spell checker that will always totally find everything. I don't think it exists. I'm sorry, that's where I'm like, I can't really give you guys a tip other than that can be kind of hard and that kind of sucks, and I'm sorry, and yes, that requires kind of going over things with a fine-tooth comb. Or get a pre-reader, which we're going to talk about in a second here, get a pre-reader who's good at finding stuff like that. There's some pre-readers who are really good at finding stuff like that. For grammar, that's something where, you know, spell checker bolt, you know, Word or Google Docs, that can be a little bit better at that stuff, but even there, you can do things that are, like, weird enough that it doesn't really know what you're doing and it thinks that it's okay, but it's like, this sentence is unreadable. I'm not going to necessarily say you should drop what you're doing and read The Elements of Style, because it will probably put you to sleep and then you'll hate me forever. I will say, and that right there is a link to a version of it that's free on the web. You can check it out. I will say, Stephen King, who is a real professional writer dude who gets paid money to do this, as opposed to me who doesn't, he thinks it's good. He thinks it's you know, it's good stuff. If you're not, like, if you don't feel like you have a good working knowledge of grammar, that's okay. No judgment. This is a resource you can go to. It is rough. It will not treat you nicely, but you know, study it, get through it at your own pace, you know, do what you can with it. Or pre-readers. Here's some specific things that I see people do, like, especially newer writers, but not exclusively newer writers. To some extent, these next couple of slides, this is stuff that, like, everybody does, including me, okay? So, like, just, we all do it. Showing versus telling. This is something that will totally turn people off, and as you're writing, you might not even notice that you're doing it. You probably won't really notice that you're doing it. But, like, if you get feedback, hey, this is really telly, this part is really telly, I want you to show me this. I've got a couple examples here from Trick Question, who's also probably better than I am. You should check her out. So a couple examples, like, you know, with enough alcohol, she might even silence the memories looping in her head. I mean, okay, so that specific line out of context, you could say, well, that, I don't know, is that excessively telly? Within the context of the story, she felt it was. It's pure tell. Don't tell things like this. Show us. So, you know, how do you say, you know, I could say, like, coffee minion looked at the coffee and he felt really, you know, drawn to the coffee. You know, I could say something like, coffee minion turned his head. He glanced at the coffee, then glanced back at his presentation. More lines. Coffee Minion looked at the coffee again. He reached an arm towards it and said, no, people are watching, I shouldn't drink it now. Yeah, like, you put little things in there. I mean, and this is just one specific example situation approach, right? But it's like, you can put little things in there that the character is doing, like, physically, or that's happening in the world, that can give you clues about what the character is thinking on the inside. I was gonna maybe put a slide in here about third person limited. I couldn't quite figure out how to do it in a good slide form. But, like, the more that you get inside of a character's head and say what exactly they're thinking and feeling, you've got to be careful. That is a valid style. That can be a perfectly valid style. But when I've done that, I've pretty consistently gotten feedback from writers who I feel are better than I am that, hey, that's Telly, stop doing that. So I'm passing that on to you as something that has happened to me that could also happen to you. If you give clues about what's going on inside the character's head through actions, through stuff that's happening around them, you know, through little glances or word choice, stuff like that, that can actually be way more effective than, like, telling exactly what they're feeling, stuff like that. All right. Next one. Lavender Unicorn Syndrome. Ah, fear the Lavender Unicorn. So there's another trick question thing. Trick question. This is something that, like, I did not know until I wrote a story and Trick Question reviewed it. It was like, hey, this is really, like, awful for Lavender Unicorn Syndrome. I was like, wow, that's good. This was not a review of my story. This was a review of a story. So you've got Lavender Unicorn Syndrome pretty bad at the start. The white bunny becomes the fluffy individual, becomes Angel Bunny, becomes the ball of white fur, becomes the bunny, right? Similarly referring to Fluttershy as the yellow Pegasus. This is something that I've had to learn the hard way. If you say, like, if you want to describe what Twilight looks like, don't. Now that feels kind of weird, because when you're writing non-pony fan, like non-pony fiction, right? Like, you have to paint a whole world, you have to create the whole thing, you know, describe everything, describe what this person is wearing, describe exactly what they're doing. You don't have to do that. We know what Twilight looks like. I mean, if you're, like, writing about unicorn Twilight as opposed to alicorn Twilight, then maybe you want to make that a little clearer, right? Just establish that. But kind of once, like, you don't need to tell us what Twilight looks like. Seriously. We know she's lavender or purple or whatever the heck color she is. We're going to get lost in the weeds if you're describing her hair colors and the stripe down the middle and stuff like that. If you're describing your OC in a story or you know, a non-canon character, okay. We don't know what they look like. You've got to help us out. But for the canon characters, stop. Don't. I have a slide in here about pony swearing. So, scub alert. This is kind of like one of my personal things. I feel like I've seen enough response from other people that I have come to believe this. It's not just my personal preference, but I feel like there's enough critical mass of people out there who feel similarly. If you put real-world swearing in your story, there's a certain percentage of the fan base that's going to be like, whoa, what'd they just say, right? You're going to pull people out of the story. They're going to have, like, that what the heck moment, right? There's lots of ponified variations on swearing. Please consider using them. Like, please consider if one of these or all the other wonderful tonified swearing alternatives would work for you with your story. You can do just about anything with stuff that they've given us in the show. Variations on the word buck, right? You can use your imagination about what to do with that one, right? Yeah, because even if people notice it, it's less likely to pull them out of the moment. Was question?
Yeah. I was actually criticized for doing just that. I used bucking. And it offended some people. Pascoy commented on that, considered that for doing that.
Oh,
but,
man.
But I will acknowledge that you will probably offend fewer people by using the pony versions. So it's still a good idea.
Pascoy is my senpai. I cannot speak against him.
That's kind of a difficult situation.
You put me in a hard place here. Okay. I cannot speak against Pascoy, but I wrote the slide.
He is just one person.
He is just one person. He is massively talented.
But
his story is
clear. I think he is right that you will probably offend fewer people if you use the pony versions.
Man, I gotta
even
say,
though Pascoy is.
His stories were honestly what hooked me on Yes, on pony fanfiction in general. So, I don't know, guys.
What stories did he write?
It's okay. Oh, he's so many good stories. That I cannot remember the titles of for the life of me right now, because this is all that my brain is full of, unfortunately. So anyway, if you must swear in your story, do it pony style. You're going to offend fewer people. I've only ever read one story by one guy who I feel like has used real-world swearing highly effectively, and like the story just would not work without it, and it totally works with it.
Is it Horizon Social Lubricant?
I've not read that story, but I would believe that Horizon could pull it off as well. It's actually a story by one of my buddies, Onion Pie. I have him in a shout-out at the end. I'll give him a shout-out now. His story, What Is Left. So if you want to read a story that's full of lots of swearing, go read Onion Pie's What Is Left. Alright, so I've talked about a lot of tips, given you guys a lot of advice. I keep mentioning pre-reading. Like, to me, this is like the secret sauce. You know, you wanna like not inflict like a super raw piece of crap on your pre-readers either. You know, just kinda go through it, give it your best shot, but like don't agonize so hard over your rough draft. Because like you don't know. Right? I mean, it's like, I don't know, it's like I wrote this thing, is it good? I don't know, right? It could be better, right? So pre-reading, Georg, he's another guy who's like way better than I am, go read his stuff. He sent me, this is just a PM that he sent me at some point, or part of a PM, right? So, you know, why are comma slices bad? You know, how many times do you use, you know, words too many times in a paragraph? Like, you don't know, right? You don't know, you know, there's like all these rules of grammar, but like how do they apply to you and what are you doing wrong? You don't know. You get someone to go look at your stuff, especially someone who's like really, you know, whose skill set includes, you know, grammar, like really good detailed grammar knowledge. They can tell you stuff you're doing wrong. And you are doing stuff wrong. Okay. I am doing stuff wrong. We all do stuff that's wrong. We could all do better, right? That's okay. That's fine. But like, get it. Hey guys, sorry to break in. My camera died somewhere during the middle of the panel, and so I lost about a half a slide's worth of content. At about the point where it died, I was talking about pre-reading and trying to introduce you to some of the value of that. It's hard to know if what you're writing really works because you're too close to it, right? You know, you've come up with this idea, you've written it down, and you think, okay, I think this works, and you might have a pretty good degree of confidence that it works, but, you know, no matter how much you edit it yourself, no matter how much you go over it by yourself, you're not going to know how a true outside observer is going to view it. And I think where the camera picked back up here is that I was starting to talk about somebody else might have ideas that you would never even think of. So I'm going to jump back in here. All right. Got it going again? Thank you very much. Yes. Sorry, my camera kind of sucks. It is what it is. Specific example of something that I never would have occurred to me, that the story would have turned out completely different if someone hadn't made a suggestion. I guess I got a couple examples. Onion Pie, guy I mentioned a moment ago. I wrote a story. It was a you know, sad derpy story where she, you know, doesn't have enough money to buy food for, you know, both herself and Dinky, and it's a situation where she's like confronting that, and that's like really hard, right? And I had another character who at the end of the story like offered to give her some money or something, and my pre-reader, you know, Onion Pie, he was like, no, don't have her solve that problem, you know, let the, like, you know, get some resolution to the immediate situation that she's in, but like, don't have this character just fix her, like, the whole situation, the whole macro problem, because that's just like, it's dull. You know, it stings more if at the end it's like, the immediate situation, yes, is a little bit better. There's still kind of the ongoing situation that isn't that great, but there's, you know, little bits of relief that are offered by the resolution of the story. And I was like, oh yeah, that's really good. So that was, yeah. If I hadn't had him read my story, it would have been way not as good. I had another story where So I mentioned the one where I ship a straw and a bag of flour, and I totally made it work. It's called the Brief Torrid Love Affair of Fernando the Straw and Madame La Flower. Yes, I mention it because it is actually funny. I got, like, talented people to help me with it. It's good. Present Perfect, another guy who's way better than I am. Yeah, so I had the original ending, Pinkie Pie's in it, and at the original ending, she went into, like, full-on cupcakes mode, and he was like, this is awful. It's like, this is bad. And I was like, oh. I was aiming for funny. I was like, no, this sucks. This is, like, not good. And I was like, oh. Well, I gotta fix that. And the ending is different now. There's still a cupcakes reference in there, because I felt like it was a situation where I, as a writer, knew there was a little bit of humor to be mined out of a cupcakes reference in a story where one of the primary characters was a food ingredient that could be made into cupcakes, and then Pinkie Pie is also there, right? I knew there was a joke there. There's something there I could get out of it. But I wrote the rough draft, and I was wrong about how to do it. So that's why I'm saying, get a pre-reader. Get talented people who are better than you are to look at your stuff, give you ideas, because you don't know. You know? You don't know what they're going to come up with. That's part of why you feel anxiety when you release a story. I mean, even if you get pre-readers, you will still feel anxiety when you release a story, because you're like, I want people to like it, and you don't know if they will. But at least if you've had people give you feedback, at least you know, like in your head you know, this is a funny story, I am happy with this, I have worked hard on this, I am satisfied with this, I feel artistically fulfilled, right? At least you know. And if people hate it, they downvote bomb it, and they say, this sucks, you're like, well, I have a higher degree of confidence now when I say, I think you are wrong, thank you for your feedback, but I disagree, I feel like this is artistically fulfilled, right? It's like that path to being happy even if people don't necessarily respond to your work as you would like them to. So, how do you find pre-readers? Three ground rules. Very important. Extremely important. One, ask nicely. This is like, you know, mind your P's and Q's. Best politeness. Two, take no for an answer. If you ask someone and they say, sorry, do not pressure them, do not hound them, say thank you and walk away and find somebody else. And yes, that might mean you have to ask a bunch of different people before you finally find somebody who's willing to do it. Guess what? It happens to all of us. It's fine. Especially if you're aiming at people with like 1,000, you know, watchers, right? You know, who are like really good writers, who are like way better than you or way better than me, or right? Like, they are busy people, they are talented, there's stuff going on in their lives. They might say no. It's probably not personal, or it could be personal, who knows? Thank them anyway. All right, thank them for their time. And if they do it, then thank them even more for their time. Because that's awesome that they did it. Okay, so who do you want to ask, right? Number one, people you know who actually write well, okay? It's like somebody who's good, who like, you read their stuff, you're like, wow, this is really good. Pascoy came up a bit ago. I have not yet worked up the courage to ask him. But at some point, I would like to actually work the courage to ask him to pre-read one of my stories. So that's an example of
do as... have to ask him.
What's that?
Just send the stuff to a question. There's a good chance it will end up in his inbox.
That's good to know. I have sent stuff to Equestria Daily. I have gotten feedback back on occasion. I have wondered if that was actually Pascoy writing that. But at some point, I would actually like to really ask him specifically to
better that way.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't think you have to like work up the courage or anything. You can send me a private message.
I'll send them a private message and interview them. The question daily.
Really?
I have the interview on YouTube.
Cool.
Yeah. I can make you do it later.
I would like to do that.
Sure.
So I guess the point is not, you know, don't get lost in the weeds there. This is kind of like do as I say, not as I do territory. I have asked people who I totally respect and who are better than I am to read stuff for me, and it has gone really well. He's the one specific one that have a thing, so don't worry about that. Yes?
There's one other place where you can find people. If you don't have any friends in fiction, like if you're just starting out and you don't know who works well yet, and you don't want to go to this random group of people, you could go to stories that you like, and many people will write comments in the comments. about what's wrong with it. And if you like what that person's saying about the story, you can send them a private message, and it's very likely that they'll say yes, because, I mean, they're already doing it right there on that story, they're reviewing it. So just ask them to do the same thing for yours.
On top of that,
and in all likelihood, they will be honored by the request. I've had people do that for me, who ask me, hey, I like what you said about this story, I was wondering if you could take a look at this one. I felt so flattered, of course I agreed.
Yeah.
Obviously, they've invested enough time and interest to read the story, and it affected them enough that they want to say something about the story. And it is a very good chance that they're going to continue on reading the story. So it would actually drag them in a lot more, as not only as a fan of your writing, but also as a potential friend.
Mm-hmm.
So go ahead and send them a, you know, make a request.
Yep. Exactly. Exactly. So great comments out there. Just to recap. You're reading a story, find a comment with some criticism that you think is really intelligent, maybe PM that person, ask them to take a look at your story. I mentioned the Authors Helping Authors group. I have, you know, there's lots of groups on Fanfiction that are, you know, ostensibly about, you know, helping to connect writers and potential pre-readers. They don't all work, right? Like, I've tried some and it's like, wow, that was a crappy experience. I actually really see, you know, some amount of the time, people actually really connect up through Authors Helping Authors. You know, somebody posts, hey, this is the kind of story I want to write. Hey, can someone help me with this? Like, I actually see that connection get made through Authors Helping Authors at least some non-zero percentage of the time. So I can point you at that specific group as well. You can also ask friends. So, like, if you have friends on Fanfiction and you, like, you know, you can ask them. They'll probably say yes because they're your friends. I put a maybe down there though. There's a difference between like someone who's your friend and like a really good writer, unless you're friends with really good writers. And that's okay. You know, we're all different. We have different strengths. You know, we all bring different things to the table in life. So you know, you may feel more comfortable asking a friend. That doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to be an amazing pre-reader. So just, you know, level set your expectations on that one a bit. So here's my slide. So you just ask these people? Yeah. Ask, you know. As I mentioned there, yes, it can feel super awkward. If you're asking someone with, like, tons and tons and tons of followers to, like, read your thing, and you have, like, one follower or zero, right? Zero followers. Wow, that's awkward. This person is, like, horse famous. I can't possibly ask them. Again, do as I say, not as I do, because I still haven't worked up the courage to ask quite yet, but I will one of these days. And they might turn you down. Like I said, nobody's getting paid for this, right? They could be busy, they could be sick, something could be going on in their life, or maybe, you know, they don't think they're a good fit for your project. Maybe you're like, you know, you pitch something, right, to them, like, hey, this is the kind of story I've got, you know, could you take a look at this? They might look at that and say, wow, that is just not my bag. I'm sorry. I cannot get into that kind of a story. And they may or may not actually say that in their response to you, but that could be a factor. You know, I've had people turn me down because they were like busy or whatever, and I've followed up, you know, later, and they've taken me up on, you know, the opportunity.
I might add to that, if you're PMing somebody that has been described by, but you're not sure if it's something that's up their alley, you can also add at the end of the PM, if this is not something that would interest you, can you refer me to someone who would be?
That's a good tip. Yes, if this is not something that would interest you, can you refer me to someone, you know, who it might be interesting to? Yeah, because especially some of the bigger authors, you know, they know lots of people, right? They can probably recommend someone or not. You never know, but they might be able to. Or very bottom of the slide, they might not turn you down. They might take you up on it. You never know. You might get real lucky. You might, like, you know, make a great connection with a really talented writer. And that can be awesome. You know, friendship is magic, right? So this can go really well sometimes. But, yeah, like, be prepared. You might hear a lot of no's before you finally get a yes. And the other thing I'll say, pre-readers don't always have all the answers, right? Every pre-reader, every reader, every writer, everybody has a different skill set. And it's sometimes hard to know up front what their skill set is. You don't want to be like, okay, I might want you to pre-read for me, but I don't know what your skill set is, so can you please tell me what your skill set is so that I can assess that, so that I can determine if that matches to what I need for my story. No, don't. Look, ask someone to read, see what you get. You know, unless you know in advance somehow what their skill set is, and you might be able to infer that from their stories, you know, things that they do very well, or comments they post on other stories, or whatever. But you, like, you don't know what you're going to get necessarily, and if it's not a fit for what you were hoping to get out of them, you know, you can follow up and say, well, you know, thank you, right? Remember, thank these people for spending their time on your thing. Thank you for that. I was wondering if you could comment on this element of the story, or, you know, you're fishing for more specific feedback, right? The more specific you are with your request, probably more likely it is that you're going to get what you were hoping for out of the interaction there. It's okay to follow up and say, I was wondering if you could tell me about this. And they may or may not be able to help you with the specific thing you need. You don't know. You might need a couple pre-readers to get what you need out of like, you know, fixing up your story. Yeah, it can happen, right? That can happen. That's realistic. Yes, it'd be great if you had the magic pre-reader who could do it all real fast. You find them, send them my way, right? I've worked with amazing people. They don't all have like 100% wall-to-wall every single skill you could possibly hope for. The flip side of that is that as you work with different people, you start to kind of get a sense of who's got what kind of skill set. So if you've got a story and you're like, I'm really having problems with this aspect of this story, well, you know who to ask. Doesn't mean they have time, but you know who to ask, right? Oh, and they, one last thing, and then I will get your question. They might be able to point you at something. They're like, something's wrong here. I don't know what it is. I don't know how to fix it. Or they might give you a suggestion. You're like, I don't know about that suggestion. But they might be able to point you at something that isn't working, and then you might have to figure out what to do with it. Yes?
I would also like to comment that when you ask people to read your story, you made it easy for them to do so. And that
yes.
means don't send them an attachment, like a Word document.
Oh, dear Lord.
Google Docs only.
Oh, my yes. gosh, Google Docs. Always use Google Docs. It is amazingly convenient for the people to just click on the link and boom, it's there on the screen. They can highlight bits of it and put the comments on the side, as opposed to like downloading a Word document and having
yes.
to write a second Word document about your first document, about what needs to be fixed, and then email that to you, put it in a
yes.
Dropbox. Oh, it's horrible.
That's how you lose editors.
Absolutely, yes. Yeah, that was another learning curve thing for me. Google Docs. Like, I didn't know that starting out. I was like, I remember when I first reached out to someone, I was like, how should I get this to you? And I think it was Onion Pie, and he was like, send me a link to your Google Doc. I'm like, Google Docs? What? Right? He's like, I don't know, right? So I learned something there, but it's been incredibly valuable. Yeah, it's...
There is no substitute.
There is no substitute. If you're giving feedback, there was a lady in a writing group that I was in. I guess technically I'm still in the writing group. I don't participate anywhere near as much as I used to. Heidi Cullinan. She gave some rules about giving feedback, okay? These are not necessarily hard and fast rules about, I put this here because, I've had slides about, you know, getting pre-readers for your stuff. The flip side of that is helping other people out, right? And, you know, if other people ask you for help, or, you know, you offer to do a pre-reading exchange, right? You know, like, then you're like, oh, wow, I'm like commenting on this person's story, you know? Hey, I don't like that sentence. I think you should change it. Yeah, right? Don't try to rewrite their story. I'm so guilty of that one. When I was going over this slide last night with my pre-reader for this, you know, we were kind of laughing. It was like, yeah, I'm pretty bad about that. Like when I edit his stuff, I do this all the time, and I should not do it. Do as I say, not as I do. You know, it's like, okay, you got a sentence, and you're like, wow, this sentence is super weird. I think you should read like this, right? Sometimes that makes sense. Sometimes. Don't do it as much as I do, okay? Please. Because it can really irk people when you start doing that.
It depends on what they want from you. In my case,
yes.
I basically pre-read and edit for some folks on Fanfiction. I'm more of the active guy that I don't just, you know, fix small things, but if I see something, you know, it's missing or something, it just doesn't play wrong, I just add my, it's not a comment, I just change the text, you know, from my view, and you can always agree or disagree with it, but
right.
Normally they get me because I'm more of the active guy, not just fixing small stuff, but I'm actually changing the story itself because of, that's me.
Yep.
That's how I work.
I tend to do similar things. And with Google Docs, I guess the good news is you're not giving something back to someone where it's like, you know, here's all this, you know, redline stuff. You should change this. This is awful, right? With Google Docs, you can insert suggestions, right? Lots of stuff. And if they don't like it, they might be like, oh, I disagree. I don't want to change that. That's kind of my bottom point there. They might not accept every suggestion you make, right? You know, you might not accept every suggestion you get from a pre-reader. They might not accept every suggestion you give them either. I will say that can be frustrating sometimes when it's like you're pre-reading a story and you're like, this is weird. Please change this. And then like you see it after it's posted, you're like, you didn't change that. It's so weird. Why did you do that?
I think that's happened to every writer.
Yeah. It's like, it is what it is, right? So some other kind of guideposts here. So like, especially if you're giving like a qualitative like overview of like, this is my short form review of your story. Always start and end with positive things. You can mention as many positive things as you want about their story. Only say 3 negative things about their story. Right. So I mean, if you're like copy editing their story or going after grammar issues, that obviously doesn't apply as hard and fast, right? But like, if you're like, you know. You've marked up their story and inserted comments and stuff, and then you're like, you know, sending them the PM back like, okay, I'm done. Here's what I think about your story. You know, they'll be like, this sucks, that sucks, this sucks, that sucks, this sucks, that sucks. But overall, I think it was good, right? Don't do that. Don't be that guy. You can say as many positives as you want. Start and end with a positive. You only get to say 3 negative things in that short form, you know, PM back to them. All right? Keep it positive, even if their story sucks.
I feel like I might be commenting too often, but
it's okay.
Sometimes when you're giving feedback as a pre-reader, it might be a good idea to sleep on things if they are kind of nebulous, and if it's something really huge. Like, if it's just little grammar points, like whatever, but
yeah,
something really important, like where you have to be really careful and explain why it should be this way, write it, and then don't submit it yet, and let a few hours go by, and then reread it.
Yep.
Because I've had times where I went on huge, huge rants in the comments of Google Docs, writing entire essays. Like, I would start writing the comments, and then I would run out of room in the comments, and I have to make a second comment to continue my essay about why it should be changed. The next day, I would be reading it, and be like, it's like, thank you, and just delete the whole thing.
I've had that experience. Now, I just looked at the time. We were perilously short on time. I have a couple slides left. I'm going to blaze through these suckers.
Yay.
Sorry. Parting thoughts. There's no one true path. All this advice I've given you, hopefully it's useful. There's no one true path. There's a lot of fun paths to wander down. Get out there and wander. Yes, Lauren Faust. Some words from Lauren Faust on, as a cartoonist, you know, drawing, right? Imagine you have 10,000 lousy drawings inside of you you have to get out before you're any good, right? I know it's about drawing, but it probably applies to writing too, right? Get out there, write stuff. Like I said earlier, you can't edit it, you can't fix it up to release it unless it exists. Get out there, write stuff, okay? Get out there, write, get started. I mean, you know, this panel's all about getting started. These are tips that you can use to help you get started and improve. Get started, right? Some of your stuff might suck at first. All of our stuff sucks at first. That's okay. Get started. I have no time to go through any of this, nor did I plan to. Bonus material that you can check out. I will help you guys get links to my slides here so you can check this stuff out. It's good stuff.
Okay.
Some shout outs. Moosetasm, my buddy, my partner in horse crime, editor of this presentation. Randall LaFaison, Onion Pie, Bluegrass Brooke, and Wooly. These are great people. Go check them out. Okay. Questions? Anything else?
A really helpful resource for writers is there's a website online called Hemingway App.
Hemingway App can be useful. I feel like it's not, I've used it. I feel like it's not entirely a substitute for pre-reading, but it can be useful as an assist.
Yes, and the more people use it, the better it gets because it's an AI.
Ah, very good.
What is it?
Hemingway App.
In your case, we don't have enough time for pre-readers, physically.
Yeah, not really.
It should few chapters a day. Yeah, right now he has the longest story in fanfiction, physically, humanly possible.
Yeah?
Yeah. What?
The chase.
2.1?
Alright, one last thing. If you would like a copy of these slides, you can go to my user page on fanfiction. My latest blog has a link to these slides in it. So you can get these slides. They have good links in them. Check it out. Catch me after if you want. I'm out of time. I'm over time. Thank you for your time. Yay!
Yay!
All right.